Bismillah Rahman Rahim. Today we have a last lecture of this semester of this course, of course. So that is the kind of a comparison of phytoremediation and biofortification, because both has involvement of minerals uptake from the soil and accumulation in the plant parts, phytoremediation and as well as biofortification. We have already discussed in details what is biofortification. Today we'll talk a little bit about phytoremediation, what is that and what are different types of phytoremediation. And after that we can compare that, what is the difference between phytoremediation and biofortification. And the lastly, we'll talk about that what can be the benefits or concerns to each other, phytoremediation or the biofortification. Starting with phytoremediation is the use of plants to remediate contaminations by the uptake of contaminated water by plants. A plant can be used to contain, remove, or degrade the contaminants. So this is very simple definition of phytoremediation and very basic, and you are much aware of that. So there are a few facts about phytoremediation. It is a part of bioremediation because in bioremediation we also use microbes, but in phytoremediation we only use plants. So it is also called as a green remediation, and sometimes it is called as botanical bioremediation. This is a very old idea, and this is very low energy, low cost, and environment friendly. In phytoremediation, the harvesting of aerial biomass is executed to remove the taken up minerals from the soil or taken up contaminant from the soil. It is also sometimes called as phytomining because we use plants to mine the heavy metals from the soil. And plants which have extracted these metals from the soil, the metals can be recycle from those aerial parts. Although it's very costly, but it can be done, and that's why it is also called as phytomining, because we use plants to mine the heavy metals. So if we have some very expensive heavy metals like gold or others which can be taken up by the plants, and we can recycle it and we can get it economic benefits, so then it's possible. But even then, if we are removing the contaminants which are not of high value, but we have to do because they are polluting our environment, so it is a side business that can be although not economical, but that can be one part of that, because we have to dump anywhere. If we are removing are extracting the metals from the soil and they are accumulated in the aerial biomass, so we have to dump it somewhere. So if we are again dumping into the soil, so then it will again contaminate that part of the soil. And if we are dumping and dumping at the same place, so then that can be toxic for underground water if that leaches down. So that's why to get rid of that, sometime we have to recycle the metals from the aerial biomass. So this is why the phytomining is used. It covers the ability of higher plants to absorb and translocate contaminants, heavy metals, organometals, xenobiotica, radioisotopes from the rhizosphere into the shoot. So all those parts which can be taken up by the plant root system and can be translocated to the aerial biomass, because from the field we cannot remove the roots, so that must be into the aerial biomass part. So these were few facts about phytoremediation. The phytoremediating plants should be fast growing, especially the shoot growth should be fast. The high biomass production, because when the biomass production is high, it means the more metals or contaminants can be extracted. Because the plants, they have a threshold that above that they cannot have high concentration of that. But if they have high biomass and even low concentration in the shoot, so that will have a big removal from the soil. So that's why it is preferred to have plants with high biomass production, high rooting capacity, length, density, depth, so that they can cover more area in the soil, easy to handle harvesting techniques, because we have to harvest it just to remove the pollutants. We may not have any economic benefits, so that's why that must be very easy. And the last, but the most important part, that is the tolerance and the accumulation of high pollutant concentration in the shoot. Because the pollutants, if we talk about heavy metals, so they must be toxic for the plants. So, but if when we are choosing the plants for phytoremediation, so they must have some tolerance for those heavy metals or contaminants so that they can survive there. They can extract only the heavy metals if they are able to survive under that polluted area. So if we have high concentration of cadmium, but the plants, they are not able to even grow there, those plants cannot be utilized for phytoremediation. What is this tolerance? We'll discuss a little bit about that. So rate of metal uptake varies between plant species. So different plant species have different uptake rate. Concentration within the plant based upon genetic, intrinsic and environmental extrinsic factors. The amount of, so that I was mentioning that the plants, they have a certain capacity or threshold to tolerate a certain concentration of that contaminant. So they may vary genetically, internal mechanism they have, or they have sometimes, if the environment is changing, so they may have varying capacity to accumulate those contaminants into the root. So what are the main strategies? So there are two main strategies for tolerance. The first one is the exclusion. Exclusion is generally of two, three types. So one exclusion is that the plants, they avoid to take up those metals from the soil. So that is not valid for here. Because we have to take it up to remove from the soil. And the second mechanism of tolerance or exclusion, so that is so exclude them from the shoot. So it means, so they are accumulating more contaminant into the root, not in the leaf, because the plants, they are excluding not for phytoremediation, so they are excluding for survival. So the most of the mechanism or metabolism, so that is being occurred in the leaves, so they will not let those contaminants to go to the leaves. But this is again not valid for us, because we want to have high concentration into the shoot. But the third strategy, which is inclusion means, so they are getting it up into the shoot and they are then sequestering somewhere in the vacuoles, because the high concentration of metals in most plant species, even they are tolerant. So this is a basic rule of basic thumb rule, that the tolerant plants, they also not have any mechanism to tolerate, especially the metabolism. The only tolerance is that they avoid it. So when they are getting into the shoots, so they are accumulating into the vacuoles in the cell, so that that may not be toxic for the plant metabolism, because most metabolism is being occurred in the cytosol. So in vacuole is just a kind of storehouse. So in that case, we have a ratio more than one. So it means we have more in the leaf as compared to that in the root. So how does it happen, the inclusion? Inclusion, sometimes it's binding to the cell walls, because we have to get it avoid from the cytosols. So when it's binded with the cell wall, so there is no such metabolism there. Reduced transport across the plasma membrane, because the metabolism is inside the membrane. So don't let it go into the cytosol across the membrane. Then active return transports. So if they are getting into, so then taken it out. So this is sometimes in exclusion in the roots. So when it's taken up into the roots, so the plants has ability to get it out. So the lesser amount is entering into the cytosol and more is going out. The rate is more. It means the plant has very efficient mechanism to get rid of that contaminant. So if it's happening in the root, so it's not valid for phytoremediation. But if it's happening for the shoot, just to keep that contaminant into the apoplast, so that may be valid for phytoremediation. So then fourth is the compartmentation. So that is very important for this phytoremediation point of view. So they have plants, they have transporters, and they get it metals or contaminants into the cytosol, and then they sequester it into the vacuoles. And in vacuole, they have high concentration of those metals as compared to that in cytosol. Then complexation. So this is another strategy, that those contaminants in the cytosol, they are equally toxic for the metabolism in contaminant tolerant plant and contaminant sensitive plant. So once the metal is getting into the cytosol, so the plants which are favorable for phytoremediation, so they have certain ability to make certain complexes with proteins or the other secondary metabolites. So when they are precipitated with those, or they are in complex with those organic molecules, so they are not disturbing the metabolism. So in that case, they can have more concentration in the cytosol, but not in the free case. So they must be complex with some organic molecules. And then again, the exclusion, which we also talk about, that they are not getting, they are not allowing the contaminants to get into the cytosol. So these were the mechanisms which are adopted by the tolerant plants. So coming toward phytoremediation, if we have plants with some tolerance, including all kind of avoidance, because the avoidance, exclusion and inclusion both can work together. Because if you have a very high concentration of contaminant in the soil, and you have a plant with both strategies, exclusion, so it means all the contaminants are the very high concentration of contaminant, they are not getting into the plant. So because the plants will not tolerate those. So the some are getting into the plant and some are being excluded from the cell membrane. And then whatever or how much that is getting into the cytosol, so that can be sequestered into the vacuole in the root or into the shoot. So if it's going into the shoot, so it's very favorable for the phytoremediation. So, but if it's more is in the root and less is in the shoot, so this is normally not required for phytoremediating plants. So if we have a tolerance, then we can use them for different phytoremediation types, rhizofiltration, phytovolatilization, phytostabilization, phytostimulation, phytodegradation, hyperaccumulators. So then we can use them in these phytoremediation types. So we will have a look briefly on each of that. Hyperaccumulators, hyperaccumulator plants are characterized by their constant metal concentration in the tissue within a large variation of soil metal concentration. So they have ability to extract those metals from low concentration to very high concentration, and they have a very constant concentration in the aerial part. So it means they can be used from medium to high concentrated polluted soils. So this is also very important, because if the plants, they are not able to maintain their concentration of contaminants into the shoot, so they will not be able to survive, because the more, if they have more concentration in the leaves, so they may not be feasible for their growth, because they have to grow. The first thing is survival. If they are surviving, so they can be utilized. If they are not surviving, they can't be. So this is very important, and they have a very high concentration, ability to accumulate very high concentration into the leaf. So we also say phyto extraction, because we use plants to extract the metals from the soil into the aerial part. That need mobilization, because the first they have to mobilize into the soil, in the soil, so that they are available for the plant. Then uptake and sequestration, so they will be taken up by the plants and they may be sequestered into the vacuoles, or they will be transported to the xylem, and then from xylem they are transported to the aerial part or shoot, where there is the unloading, and then further transport and sequestration in different parts of the plant shoot, maybe in the leaves or other parts. So these, all these mechanisms, so they involved many of the transporters in the cell membrane. So they must be ability. For example, if we have high concentration of iron and zinc or manganese, so the plant do have their mechanism to take up, because they are also essential elements. But if they the pollutants, they are cadmium or other metals, so they are not essential element for the plants. So they may not have, some plants may not have transporters to take up those heavy metals. So in that case, so we must be able to find the plants which have those kind of transporters. But of course, that is something which is to do with the research, not with the in general selection of the phytoremediation, phytoremediating plants. Difference in zinc accumulation between two species. The first is T. arvinus. You can see here that the epidermal cells, they are accumulating into the vacuole. Again, into the vacuole, there is a very low transport to the xylem, and there is a, it means there is a low translocation toward the shoot. But we have another which has a high intake, uptake, and they have a low concentration in the vacuole, but they have a high translocation toward the xylem. So it means these plants, they are more able to be utilized by utilized for phytoremediation, because they are transporting more metals toward the shoot. So then we have phytodegradation, degradation of contaminants. So they take up the plant, the contaminants, and then they degrade it so that they may not be toxic for the plant. So this is a bit advanced, that they change the chemistry of that contaminant to make it less toxic. Internal metabolic process is involved in that. And sometimes it is external release of enzyme. The enzymes are released and then they make it degraded. And then that can be taken up by the plants. Or they can degrade it there, so that is not very toxic for the plants, for the other plants. So if you want it to degrade it here, so that is not toxic by the way. So in that case, it is not necessary that the plants take up. They can just release some enzyme which can degrade those contaminants, and then that is also a kind of phytoremediation. Rhizofiltration, in that the plants, they are used in the hydroponics, which have high contamination, especially in the waters, standing water, where there is a metal contamination. In this technology, the plants, they are being grown and then they are being put into that water, and they extract the metals into their aerial part, and then the water has a less concentration. In the phytovolatilization, so the plants, they have also ability to take up the contaminants, and then they volatilize them into the atmosphere. So after degrading, the mercury is the one example which can be phytovolatilized through the plants. So it means they are taking the contaminants from through the roots, and then they are not accumulating in the plant tissue. They are just degrading it and then making it less toxic and then releasing it into the atmosphere. So that is phytovolatilization. Phytostabilization means they release, plant release some enzymes or hormones which reduce the mobility of heavy metals. And then phytostimulation, so when they reduce the mobility, it means that they are stable, they are not toxic for the plant growth. If we are growing other crops there, so they will not be taken up by the plants, and they are just stabilized there into the soil, and they know that soil is safe to be used for agriculture purpose. Then we have accomplished by decreasing wind blown dust, minimizing soil erosion, and reducing contaminant solubility or bioavailability to the food chain. Then we have phytostimulation, is the process where root release compounds enhance the microbial activity in the rhizosphere. So they stimulate the microbes to degrade or to stabilize the contaminants. So now coming toward the phytoremediation versus biofortification. There are basically four major steps. So here we have a phytoremediation, and then here we have a biofortification. Phytoremediation, increased biomass production through agronomic and genetic intervention, because we have to just get the biomass with high concentration of those contaminants. But in case of biofortification, we have to localize them into the edible parts. So we don't need them in the leaf, but we need them into the grains. In the second stage of the phytoremediation, detoxification in plant shoot. So they may be detoxified in the plant shoot. But in case of biofortification, we must remobilize them. We don't want to see them in the shoot. We must remobilize them toward the grains. And the third, that is improving uptake and translocation. And in case of biofortification, we have again the same. If we have a similarity here, then the bioavailability of elements and bioavailability of elements in both cases. So these, the first two stages, starting from the roots, so they are similar, and then the next two stages, so they are so different in phytoremediation and in biofortification. So the first strategy, so that is in biofortification, localization in endosperm, localization of mineral in the aleurone and the embryo is the limiting factor for biofortification. So we want to get it into the endosperm mechanism to be understand to transport into endosperm. Endosperm specific overexpression of soybean ferritins is one example. Decrease anti-nutrient, enhance the nutrient promoter. So that is also one task for biofortification. But in case of phytoremediation, low biomass of some hyperaccumulator limit their use for phytoextraction. So we need high biomass. Increase biomass by breeding, agronomic or transformation, that can be done. Phytoextraction can be combined with the bioenergy production using the biomass plants. So the, in the phytoextraction, the plants which are harvested from those contaminated area, they, those can be utilized for bioenergy production. And then of course the some metal will be degraded, the other may be extracted from the ash or maybe utilized somewhere. So there is another well use of that ash we will discuss perhaps later on, because that ash may have a high concentration of zinc and iron, and then that ash can be utilized as a fertilizer to biofortify the other crops. Then biofortification remobilization to the grain, remobilization mineral to the grains, remobilization to the edible part. And in case of phytoremediation, vacuole sequestration of metals driven by tonoplast transporters, then complexation, because we want to sequester them into the vacuole, so we may enhance that capacity by utilizing the transporters. Complexation of metals with the organic acid into the vacuole or into the cytoplasm. To reduce the toxicity, then metabolic diversion or volatilization of toxic element to less toxic element. So that I mentioned in phytovolatilization. So they degrade them and convert them in less toxic elements and then be volatilized. Then we have decreased mobilization to edible parts. So to edible part we need less because they are toxic for the plants. Then biofortification, uptake and root to shoot translocation, identification of traits to enhance uptake and translocation toward shoot, overexpression of gene to enhance uptake and translocation, reduce uptake and translocation of heavy metals. So this is very important when we talk about the biofortification. We will see in the last slide as well. We have already discussed in detail, then in phytoremediation, hyperaccumulators have enhanced uptake of metals, which can be enhanced by hyperexpression of transporters. Hyperaccumulators have also efficient translocation system. So because they have to translocate from root to shoot, so that is efficient system and that can be further enhanced. Reduce sequestration into the reduced, so this is a target for the phytoremediation.